There's an old idea that you have to rescue your dead father from an abyss. And that's sort of associated in some sense with the Nietzschean idea of the death of God. You know, and every generation goes through its crisis of meaning. So the question is, well, where do you find the spirit that revives? And the answer is, in the darkest possible place. And see, this is where I think that conservatives go wrong. My lectures, well, tonight wasn't a particularly classic example, but my lectures tend to be very dark. There is darkness in this one. I mean, there is an inalienable reality of finitude and suffering that characterizes people's lives. And it's not surprising that they become bitter. They become embittered and resentful. And that has to be forthrightly examined as deeply as possible before anything optimistic can emerge. Because you have to say, look, I understand why you feel the way you feel. But despite all that, and all of that is a lot, that proper antidote is the ethical way of life. And not only is it the proper antidote because it's your duty, which is another thing that conservatives stress, it's deeper than that. It's because it actually works. No, you need a meaningful life. It's not optional, because that combats the suffering. And more than that, if you lead a meaningful life, which means to adopt responsibility almost inevitably, you actually make things better. Right. And so you can take people down to the bottom of the abyss and you can say, it's no wonder that you despair given your finitude, but there's so much possibility that surrounds you that you can make something of that regardless of its of the reality of its horror. And you do that with responsibility. And people understand that. And so it isn't just a call to making things better. It's not a call to a utopia that's produced by human imagination. It's the insistence that without the proper engagement in truth, that your life will degenerate and you will end up embittered and in hell. And so the conversation just hasn't been serious enough, I would say. And that's especially bad for young people. You know, one of the things I tell young people all the time, I'm not a very typical psychologist in this regard, because psychologists like to pat people on the head and say, you're all right the way you are. I talked to Bishop Barron a while ago, I'm going to broadcast this, and he said that the Catholic priests were trained in the 1960s to kind of be accepting, you know, humanistically, mm-hmm. You're okay the way you are, you know. And that's such rubbish. It's like, not only are you not okay the way you are, you don't think that anybody else is okay the way they are either. And you don't think your children are okay the way they are, like you love them and all that, but you don't want them to stay 3 years old their entire life. You want them to expand and improve and become who they are. And so instead of telling young people that they're okay the way they are, I tell them that, and it's a terrible message for them if they're desperate. You know, so let's say 10% of the people in my audience are young, maybe they're young men, just for the sake of argument. And they're like not in good shape. They don't have any goals. They're drinking too much. They're watching pornography all the time. They've got no aim. They've got no structure in their life. And they're just bloody miserable. And the misery is twisting them into malevolence, because enough misery will absolutely do that to you. And then what are you going to do? And come along and say, well, you're okay the way you are? It's like, that's the last thing they want to hear. It's like, get your damn act together. You know, you got things to do and they're going to be difficult. And that there's an echoing Christian message in there, I would say, which is you pick up the weight of your suffering voluntarily and you walk uphill with it. And that not only gives you the meaning that you need in your life to stop you from degenerating in a dangerous manner, but it actually makes things better. And so that all has to be part of it. Like, I believe in human ingenuity. I think we can solve all the problems that beset us. But it can't just be, it has to be more than we can enhance material well-being, right, which is what it tends to be now. It's not enough. And so, and you get brushed off by the apocalyptic types.
Yeah, there's that creativity that only comes from the individual consciousness, and it can't be simply reduced to some kind of a formula or a machine. It's mysterious in some way, which is why I think your recourse to the archetypal structures of Genesis is so illuminating. But there was one thing you said about that that I just wanted to pursue a little bit, if I may. The idea that we can't not operate like this is what's especially compelling in your portrayal.
Yeah, good luck.
Yeah, exactly, good luck, precisely.
Well, that's the thing that's so strange, is that, you know, Nietzsche thought we could create our own values, right? That was his solution to the death of God.
Right.
But you can't, because, well, Dostoevsky figured this out, right? Mm-hmm. In Crime and Punishment, for example. You try breaking a moral rule, especially one of your own, mm-hmm, and then try convincing yourself that it's okay. It's like, good luck with that, man. You break a moral rule that's sufficiently deep, you'll traumatize yourself and you'll never recover. And if you break one that's, you know, maybe just of medium size, well, all that'll happen is you'll wake up at 3 a.m, you know, night after night, perhaps for years, torturing yourself because of the mistake you made. And if you could create your own values, you dispense with that in 2 seconds, you'd say, well, that was my decision. There's no fundamental meaning to reality whatsoever. I can do whatever I choose, and I'm not going to be guilty about it. It's like,
and the point is, that's neither true nor functional.
It's neither true nor functional.
Yeah,
it's functional in a psychopathic manner.
Yeah, right.
You know,
kind
because
of toxic.
Well, you know, the closest people, the people who are closest to be able to do that are psychopaths. But, like, their outcomes aren't that great. They don't do that well. Despite what you read about, you know, psychopathic CEOs, they don't do that well. And most people cotton on to their tricks, and generally they spend nomadic lives because they have to go from place to place because people catch on to their deceit. And, you know, they're quite prone to suicide and spontaneous emotional collapse. Mm-hmm. So, no, you have this moral law that you...
Exactly, yeah. But this is one way in which our position as being image bearers of God is a misleading parallel, insofar perhaps as God uses his words to create order out of chaos. And we can create order too by speaking truly. The difference being that we don't know whether there were any constraints at all constraining his choice at the beginning of the process. But we do know that we live within a context ourselves, both physically, naturally, as well as morally, that constrains our choice. We can either recognize our moral obligations, as you said, or try and elide them. And it's not successful, but we can try. And I've just noticed one thing that seems a little odd. Tell me if this strikes you as odd or not, or maybe I'm missing something. In an era when identity politics seems to be everything, and as you said, a lot of postmodernism has devolved into this notion that there's nothing but competing groups with their different self-contained mindsets competing for power, and never the twain shall meet epistemologically, and so forth. That's certainly the case. And at the same time, doesn't there seem to be coexisting with that a kind of a mutated individualism, which is alike what you just mentioned of Nietzsche, namely the idea that I'm an individual, I'm the creator of meaning, I can use my own words or my own will to create my own identity. I'm not obligated to independent moral obligations. I create moral obligations.
Yeah.
How can this kind of mutated toxic individualism coexist with identity politics?
Well, things that you chase, what is it? You can chase nature out with a pitchfork, but she always comes rushing back in.
Right.
You know, if you one of the things I tried to do in Maps of Meaning, which was the first book I wrote, was to write a description of what distinguished a religion from an ideology. And one of the things that distinguishes a religion from an ideology is a religion takes everything into account. It's like, well, there's a tyrannical element of culture, but there's also the benevolent element. And there's the tyrannical element or the destructive element of nature, but there's also the creative element. And there's the heroic element of the individual, which would be embodied, say, in Christianity in the figure of Christ, but there's also the adversary. Mm-hmm. There's always this balance.
Yeah.
With, if you think everything is a social construct, so it's all social, well, the individuality is going to creep back in somewhere, and it does it in exactly the form. It's this very, very childish form, right? Because it's so immature, it's so underdeveloped. It's like, well, we're entirely socially constructed, except that moment to moment we can determine our gender and by our own individual choice.
And everyone has to bow down to that determination.
Yes, well, and that's also what makes it so childish, is that not only is it an incoherent doctrine, because you can't have it both ways. You're not socially constructed and able to choose your gender.
Right.
Those things don't go together.
Right.
But the idea that your identity, now self-produced, also takes precedence over the negotiation you have to have with other people about what your identity is going to be, is really at the same development level, I would say, as a two-year-old. And I mean that technically, because two-year-olds cannot take their own identity and integrate it with the identity of other children. They can't do that until they're about three. And so it's so infantile that it's almost beyond imagination.
Well, it's like-